Hello everybody, welcome to EduTab and welcome to the revision series of NABARD Grade A 2020. So I know that we are in the midst of a global pandemic and I hope that you all are safe in your houses, but I want to remind you that now you have cleared the phase 1 exam and don't lose your focus. Please start preparing for phase 2 and use this time that you are spending in your house in quarantine, use this time to study for the examination. And now also we know that exam has been postponed, there is no specific date announced by NABARD, so you all have time to prepare for ARD static also. Generally lot of students ignore ARD static part, but now you have time, so please prepare for this part of syllabus also, because if we see the phase 1 examination of this year, lot of questions were asked from the static part. That's why please prepare for this part also. And in today's video we're gonna discuss about the very important topic of ARD static, which is fisheries. So fisheries is a very important topic of ARD. That's why we are going to cover that in this particular video. And if you have any query, then you can mail us at hello@edutab.co.in. And also we are running a 50% off on our NABARD courses. You can use the code NABARD50 to avail this discount. So let's start with this video. But first I want to tell you about our results of 2019. So in NABARD Grade A only there were 25 selections out of 41, and these were the results of Grade B and RBI Grade B. Then in 2018 in NABARD Grade A, 26 selections were there out of 46, and this is for SEBI, and this result was for RBI Grade B. So your name can also be under these selections if you prepare wisely. So let's start with today's video. First question is, how many chambers are there in the heart of fishes? Guys, it's a very easy question. These kind of questions are expected, that you all know these kind of questions actually. If you want to clear the phase 2 examination, you should know these kind of questions. How many chambers are there in the heart of fishes? Options are 2, 3, 4, 1 or none of the above. Come on guys, answer, how many chambers are there in the heart of fishes? Correct answer is option first, that is 2. So in the heart of fishes, 2 chambers are there. So one chamber is the atrium and another chamber is ventricle. So these are the 2 chambers in the heart of fishes. But when we talk about mammals and birds, then those have 4 chambered heart, means 2 atrium and 2 ventricles. So humans are also mammals, right? So humans also have 4 chambered heart, 2 atrium and 2 ventricles. If we talk about reptiles and amphibians, then those have 3 chambered heart, that is 2 atrium and 1 ventricle. So this is how there is a difference between the hearts of different organisms, and you need to remember that. Next question is, the rearing of fishes for obtaining meat and oil is known as what? Again, a very important question, and actually these kind of questions are asked in the exam. If you see the previous paper, these kind of questions were asked. Options are pisciculture, merino culture, cage culture, ichthyology or none of the above. Rearing of fishes, please focus upon the word rearing. Rearing of fishes for obtaining meat and oil is known as what? Correct answer is option first, that is pisciculture. So pisciculture is the culture in which fishes are reared for obtaining meat and oil. So fishes are reared basically for economical purpose, and that is the basic objective of pisciculture. And there is a minute difference between ichthyology and pisciculture. And what is that? Pisciculture is the rearing of fishes, while ichthyology is a branch of zoology which deals with the study of fishes. So that is the basic difference. Pisciculture is rearing and ichthyology is the study of fishes. And ichthyology focuses mainly on 3 types of fishes: bony fish, jawless fish or cartilaginous fishes, right? And there was one option there in the options which was cage culture. So cage culture is also related to fishes, and in this, or you can say the cage culture is an aquaculture production system where fishes are held in floating net pen. So as you can see in this picture, this is a floating net pen in which fishes are held. So this system is known as cage culture. This is also used for fishes. So I hope that you understand the difference between pisciculture, ichthyology and cage culture. All are related to fishes, but there is a minute difference between all of them. Now, third question is, the cod liver oil extracted from fishes is a good source of which of the following vitamins? So, one information we have got from the question itself, that cod liver oil is extracted from the fishes. Actually, it is extracted from the liver of fishes. Now, tell me, this particular oil is a good source of which of the following vitamins? Options are vitamin B and C, A and D, A and B, B and D, or A and C. Cod liver oil, you need to remember. So the correct answer is option second, that is vitamin A and vitamin D. So cod liver oil is a good source of these vitamins, vitamin A and D. So as I told you, that cod liver oil is extracted from the liver of fishes and it is the richest source of omega 3 fatty acid. That can also be asked in the exam, that which oil is the richest source of omega 3 fatty acid. Answer is cod liver oil, which is extracted from the liver of fishes, and this oil is also a good source of eicosapentaenoic acid and docosapentaenoic acid. And these are also a good source of vitamin A and vitamin D. So we all know that due to the deficiency of vitamin D, a disease called rickets occur in the children, and due to the deficiency of vitamin A, a disease called color blindness occurs. So that's why we need to protect ourselves from the deficiency of these vitamins, and a good source of these vitamins is the cod liver oil. Next question is, which of the following reason is true for Minamata disease? Now, Minamata disease is a very famous disease, you can say, and it is related to a particular country. That's a hint for you. Now, tell me, which of the following is true for Minamata disease? Options are consumption of beef contaminated with cobalt, consumption of fish contaminated with mercury, consumption of pork contaminated with nickel, consumption of fish contaminated with enriched uranium, or consumption of pork contaminated with mercury. So two things you have to identify in this question. First, that consumption of what? Fish, pork, or beef, or contaminated with which element, you can say cobalt, mercury, nickel, uranium, or mercury. Two things you have to identify related to Minamata disease. Correct answer is option second, that is consumption of fish contaminated with mercury. This is true for Minamata disease. So as I told you, that this disease is related to a particular country. So it is related to Japan actually. So what happened, that in 1956 in Japan, Minamata disease was spread due to consumption of seafood, especially sea fishes. Why? Because sea water that was near to the Japan, that was contaminated with mercury content, right? And when fishes were reared through this water, and then those fishes were consumed by the people, this Minamata disease was spread due to the contamination of mercury. So mercury affects the central nervous system of the humans. That's why Minamata disease affects the central nervous system of the humans. So I hope that it is clear in your mind that Minamata disease was related to the consumption of fishes which were contaminated with mercury. Next question that we have here is that which of the following fish species is exotic to India? So exotic fish species has been asked. That means these kind of fishes are not in India. These are exotic to India. Which of the following is fish species is that? Options are mrigal, salmon, rohu, katla, or golden carp. Guys, species are again very important. We have studied in animal husbandry also that questions related to species are asked very much. So that's why these kind of questions become very important for you. So correct answer is option fifth, that is golden carp. So golden carp is a species of fish which is exotic to India, means this fish is not produced in India. So golden carp is commonly known as crucian carp. Remember that. And the main purpose for the import of this fish is to use it as a food. So golden carp is used as a food, and please remember that these are the freshwater fish species. They can also survive well in confined water also, but by their nature, by their origin, they are freshwater fish species. Next question is, according to FSSAI, what is the recommended freezing temperature for fish freezing? Now you have to tell me the freezing temperature for fish freezing according to FSSAI. So FSSAI has actually made a standard for everything, and that's why there is a standard for freezing temperature for fish also. What is that temperature? Correct answer is option first, that is minus 18 degrees Celsius. So this is the recommended temperature for fish freezing by the FSSAI. So FSSAI is the Food Safety Standards Authority of India, and they have told that the freezing process is not considered as complete until the product temperature reaches to the minus 18 degrees Celsius or slower. So if temperature is higher than this, then freezing process shall not be regarded as complete, and the product shall be kept deep frozen to maintain the quality during transportation, storage and distribution, and this much is the temperature that is needed to freeze the fishes according to FSSAI. So please remember this temperature. Next question is, isinglass is a type of byproduct of fish industry, is principally used for what? So one thing we have learn from the question itself, that isinglass is actually a byproduct of fish industry. That can also be asked in the question form in the exam, that isinglass is related to, or is it is a byproduct of which industry? Answer would be fish industry. Now it is used for what? Clarification of vinegar, wines and beer, feeding cattle or poultry, preparation of color in semiconductor production, or none of the above. Come on guys, answer this question. So actually there is a trick in this question, and by that trick you can clearly answer this question, or you can clearly remember that we all know that vinegar, wines and beer, these all are stored in glass, right? In glass bottles these are stored. So that's why isinglass is related to clarification of vinegar, wines and beer. So you can remember this by remembering that these all are stored in glass. That's why isinglass is related to the clarification of vinegar, wines and beer. Answer is option first. So isinglass is actually a gelatin like material, and it is obtained from swim bladder or air bladder of the fishes, and principally it is used for clarifying of wines, beer, and also they are used for making of purses, honeycomb, book and ribbon, and the best quality of isinglass is prepared in Russia. And these are also used for the preparation of special grade cement and plaster. So these are the uses of isinglass, and these are obtained from the swim bladder or air bladder of certain fishes. Next question that we have here is that highlight the ideal size of cage culture developed by CMFRI. So generally sizes of cages or sizes of the space that is required for the animals, these kind of questions are actually favorite of NABARD. So please remember these things, because those kind of questions are asked in the phase 1 as well as in the phase 2 of previous examination. So you need to tell me that what is the ideal size of cage culture developed by CMFRI. Cage culture is related to fishes, that I have already told you, and I also show you the picture of cage culture in the, I think, in question number 2. So cage culture is the one in which fishes are held in a cage. So that is the cage culture. This is the cage here. So what should be the ideal size of cage culture developed by CMFRI? Correct answer is option 3, that is 6 meter. So 6 meter should be the ideal size of cage. So fish can be cultured in one of the 4 culture systems. Either they can be cultured in ponds, in raceways, in recirculating systems or cages. So cages is the net pen, or it is a system that confines the fishes in a mesh enclosure. And according to CMFRI, they have developed open sea cages of 6 meter diameter and 15 meter diameter to grow fish culture. And for sea rearing, 2 meter diameter of HDPE cages should be there. So that's why the ideal size of cage is 6 meter, because it is easy to maneuver in the size in the cages of that size. And for fingerling, 2 meter cages can be used. So guys, these are very important information that is given here. The sizes of the cages are given according to CMFRI. So please remember them. Next question that we have here is that drying of fishes by lowering temperature is known as what? Salting, freeze drying, chilling, smoking or pickling. Drying of fishes by lowering temperature. you can easily answer this question even if you don't know this question, this answer. So lowering temperature is known as what? Lowering temperature is freezing. So by freezing, drying of fishes is known as what? Freeze drying. So as its name suggests, freeze drying is the method in which fishes are dried by lowering the temperature. That's why answer would be option second, that is freeze drying. So freeze drying can fishes can be preserved by various methods like salting, freezing and chilling, and freeze drying method is one of them, in which fishes are stored below minus 18 degrees Celsius temperature, and at this temperature all the activities of microorganisms are stopped, so you can preserve the fishes at this particular temperature. The other methods were salting. So what happens in salting is that the water content in the fishes, that is reduced, and when less water will be there, less microbial growth will be there and there would be the less chance of spoilage. So by the process of salting, we can preserve the fishes. Next was the chilling. So chilling is the method in which fishes are cooled to prolong the shelf life of the fishes. Then there was smoking. So smoking is basically a method to give special taste to the fishes. So in this method, fishes are put in a smoke so that a unique taste and flavor comes in those. And the last option was pickling. So in this method, fishes are used to make pickles. So when fishes are converted into pickles, that method is known as pickling. So I hope all the options that I've explained to you, the difference between those is clear in your mind. Next question that we have here is that for a longer period, preservation temperature of prawn is in the range of what? So if we want to preserve the prawns for longer period, how much temperature is required? 0 to minus 10, minus 20 to minus 25, minus 10 to minus 15, minus 30 to minus 35, or none of the above. So again, question related to temperature, very important. So the correct answer is option 4, that is minus 30 to minus 35 degrees Celsius. This should be the temperature to preserve the prawns for the longer period. So prawns can be sold fresh if they are going to be consumed within 3 days, but if you want to store them more than 3 days, then they need to be stored in a colder temperature, and that temperature should be between minus 30 to minus 35 degrees Celsius. So please remember these values. Next question that we have here is that in case of multiple stocking and multiple harvesting method of culture practice, what is the minimum weight of fish required for harvesting? Options are 100 gram, 1 kg, 500 gram, 200 gram, 2 kg. What is the answer here? What should be the minimum weight of fish that is required for harvesting? So basically, multiple stocking and multiple harvesting method, in this particular method, fishes of bigger sizes are harvested. So what should be the minimum weight required for fishes to be harvested under this method? Correct answer is option 3, that is 500 gram. So half kg should be the minimum weight of the fish that is required under this harvesting method. So multiple stocking and multiple harvesting, which is also known as MSMH. So please remember, MSMH is multiple stocking and multiple harvesting, and it is a system of composite fish farming. And this fish, under this method, fish production can be increased from 6 to 10 tons per hectare per year. And under this method, harvesting is done after the fishes attain a size of 500 grams. So when fishes are small, those are not harvested under this method. When they attain a size of 500 grams or more, then only fishes can be harvested under this method. Next question that we have here is that fish living neither close to bottom nor near the shore is known as what? Demersal fish, pelagic fish, reef fish, onshore fish, or none of the above. So guys, various type of fishes have different kind of behavior. So some fishes live near the shore, some fishes live near the bottom, or some fishes lives in between. So the fishes, those lives in between, that is asked in this particular question. That is, the fishes that lives neither close to the bottom nor near the shore is known as what? Correct answer is option second, that is pelagic fish. So pelagic fishes are the one which lives neither close to the bottom nor near the shore. So please remember that pelagic fishes are the one. So what are the demersal fish? So demersal fishes are the one who lives near to the bottom. So these type of fishes lives in deep water. Then there are reef fishes. So reef fishes are the one which are related to coral reef. So the fishes which lives near the coral reefs are known as reef fish. Then there is onshore fish. So as its name suggests, these kind of fishes lives near the shore, right? That's why they are known as onshore fish. So I hope that you understand the basic difference between these kind of fishes, and please remember that because this is very important from the examination point of view. So these things I have already explained you in the question itself. Please revise that. So guys, that was it for today's video. In this video, we have seen 12 questions related to fisheries, and it was part first of fisheries. So we will cover more questions related to fisheries in part second. And if you have any query, then please mail us at hello@edutab.co.in. You can also call us on this number. So thank you so much for watching this video. Bye-bye, take care, happy learning, and be safe in your houses.